So I finally did it. After stating in a video from 2017 that I would finish a DIY drone by 2022, I'm happy to say that I was finally able to put together this drone, which can in fact fly, but I'm still a beginner when it comes to controlling it. Now you probably already noticed that this is not your standard drone, like for example DJI mostly makes them, which fly rather slow and controlled so that you can make beautiful recordings. No, this is an FPV or first person view drone, meaning you can not only see what the drone sees while flying, but it also moves way faster through the air and thus lets you capture some unique video footage with the help of a GoPro on top. And the reason why I built this was that months ago I got a beginner's FPV drone kit that came with a tiny drone, which works wonderfully but can easily get blown away by the wind. So I wanted something a bit bigger and heavier, and I feel like I went overboard here, but you will see that later. Before that though, let me show you my journey of building this thing, which was not super easy to do because the drone market just overflows with different hardware, communication protocols and software. But luckily, after this video, you should have a good idea of what is going on, and you should be able to build something similar. So let's get started. This video is sponsored by Keysight, who have a huge virtual event coming up called Keysight World Innovate. It is 4 days long, and during that time, industry leaders and experts will share their vision of future technology, which involves 5G and 6G, electric and autonomous vehicle advances, quantum technology, and much, much more. If that sounds interesting to you, then check out the link in the video description. Let's start off by exploring what parts we need for a drone, and let's use my completed one as an example. The first obvious part is of course a frame, onto which all other components get mounted on. Next are the motors with propellers, that create the upward thrust while spinning. And of course, we also need a battery to power it all. Then some kind of receiver that, like the name implies, receives a signal from a remote so that the drone knows what direction to follow. And since we're dealing with an FPV drone, we also need a camera and a VTX system with fitting antenna, of which I honestly also never heard of before. It stands for video transmitter, and it basically takes the camera video signal and sends it out as a 5.8 GHz signal that the FPV goggles, which we also need, can then receive and play back. And the last things they're missing are the VC board and ESC board. Now FC stands for flight controller, and it's basically the heart of the system. It for example comes with an accelerometer IC, which the drone uses to find out how it is positioned in the air. And through the help of an integrated PID control loop, it can then tell each motor how fast to spin so that it can stand upright in the air without crashing. Of course, it also manages the receive controller signal, camera signal, outputs the VTX signal, and much, much more. The only big thing it cannot do directly is driving the BLDC motors, for which we got the ESC board, aka electronic speed controller board, that drives the motors at a specific speed depending on how the flight controller demands it. And those were all in all the basic components required for an FPV drone. And I started my component hunt by firstly looking for a frame. The reason is that depending on whether you choose a small or big frame, all the other components have to be smaller or bigger too. And honestly speaking, I didn't feel like buying a pre-made frame, because when 3D printing a frame, you can always easily replace parts, and by using PETG filament, you also get reasonably strong parts, which eventually though can also break. So I searched for suitable models on printables, and eventually found this 6-inch one whose design I really liked. I asked its creator whether I can showcase it in the video, And he agreed and even helped me a lot during the builds, so big thanks to him. And with the model selected, I started 3D printing all parts. And while that was going on, I was looking for motors on Amazon, which the model creator actually advised me not to use. The reason is that they often come with low quality bearings, so he instead recommended this motor in combination with a 4S battery. With the given KV rating, using a 4S battery should give me an average RPM of 37,814, which is above the RPM thrust graph I created in a previous video, and thus it should easily lift 500 gram, meaning 4 of them should be able to do 2 kilogram, which I thought was more than enough. And by the way, I would highly recommend checking out the video I just mentioned, because it shows you very well how battery, ESC, motor and propeller interplay with one another. But anyway, the datasheet of the motor also stated that even with only 50% thrust, it is capable of lifting 563 gram. So I was pretty sure that those should work. Next for the propellers, I was advised to get 6-inch ones. But once I saw how close they get to the drone, maybe turning it into drone goulash, I instead went with generic 5-inch ones. For the battery, like I said before, I went with a 4S one, with a capacity of 2.2 amp hours and most importantly a high C rating, which basically says that it can output a high current and thus a high power, which is more than enough to enjoy the maximum power of all four motors. Moving on, next was the receiver and remote parts, and for that I wanted to reuse the remote from my beginner's drone kit. Luckily, it apparently comes with the ELRS communication protocol that can be used for modern drones. As a comparison, back in the old days, all your drone remote inputs would alter one data channel at the receiver, which is basically a standard servo signal. But since dealing with so many data channels is just confusing, modern remotes and receivers just talk to the flight controller through a receive and transmit line, and thus we reduced, for example, 9 data wires to just 2. The bad news is though that there are a ton of different protocols from different manufacturers. But like I said, ELRS is apparently not only supported by my remote, but also new and great, and I could easily get a fitting 2.4 GHz ELSR receiver for pretty cheap from the internet. So next, I also wanted to reuse my old goggles, which was also not a problem because all 5.8 GHz transmitter systems should work with them. So I simply got one that was currently available. And the camera was also a suggestion from the model creator, which I didn't regret. Okay, last but not least, a flight controller and ESC. And here I was told that pretty much anything would work, as long as the ESC could handle the motor current, the flight controller comes with a standard size, and it uses Betaflight, which is the software on the flight controller that basically handles everything, and that probably most drone owners use. So I decided on the SUSE 60 amp one, because it looked well made and came with a decent manual. And thus, I finally got all the parts for the drone. And if you want to build something similar, you can of course find a complete parts list with example seller in the video description. There you can of course also find the additional parts like screws, standoffs, zip ties and everything else. And with that being said, I started the actual drone build by firstly securing all the motors to the motor arms and then attaching those to the bottom piece of the frame with more screws. At this point, I was happy to find out that the motor wires were long enough to reach the ESC, so I tied them to the arms with the help of zip ties before soldering the XT60 battery connector to the ESC along with all the motor wires. Next, I soldered the camera wires, receiver wires and VTX wires to the solder pads of the flight controller like its manual told me to do so. And after connecting the ESC and FC with the help of the given wire, it was already time for the first power test with my lab bench power supply, which, as you can hear and also see, was a big success for me since nothing blew up. And best of all, the camera system already worked without configuring anything, which was pretty neat. What I still had to do though was binding the receiver with my controller, and that was more or less a nightmare, because no matter what I tried, my remote didn't want it to do that. Eventually I found out that my remote is the FR Sky version, which does not support ELRS, and thus I had to get a new one which does support that, but it was certainly not new. The story continues though, because the binding with the bind button still didn't function. I actually had to not only flash a new firmware onto the remote, but also a new firmware onto the receiver, which was not hard to do, but finding that out just took me way too long. And thus, the remote and receiver finally bound correctly, and it was time for me to assemble the rest of the frame to find out how I had to modify it so that it can hold my camera, GoPro mount and VTX antenna. The model creator also helped me a bit with that, and since he uploaded the step files of his model, I had no problem adjusting a couple of holes and cutouts as well, and printing some parts again. And that means it was finally time to permanently mount the FC and ESC to the frame, secure the camera with small screws on the front, as well as the antenna mount in the back, add standoffs all around the frame, use zip ties to keep all the wiring under control, attach the GoPro mount to the upper frame, and finally attach that to the rest with the help of more screws. And just like that, the drone was mostly done. And next I had to connect it to a computer and use the Betaflight configurator software to get all the settings right. To do that, I first laid the quads onto a flat surface to calibrate the accelerometer, and afterwards I configured the receiver system, made sure that the board alignment was correct so that in this software the drone moves exactly like it does in real life. I had to alter two controller channels so that the quads moves with the controller inputs like you would expect it. I had to add modes to, for example, arm the quads and enter angle modes, which is easier to fly. And ultimately, I checked the motor settings and spun up the motors to find out that they in fact all spun in the correct direction. And if you want more information about all of the Betaflight settings, then I would highly recommend checking out the Joshua Botwell channel, who made a video series about this. But anyway, with the configuration complete, I added the propellers to the motors, while making sure which ones are the clockwise and counterclockwise ones. And after then charging up the battery and securing it to the frame with Velcro strips, it was finally time for the first proper test in my hands, to see whether the drone would follow the directions I pointed to with the controller, which it did just fine. So I did a proper flying test next, which wasn't as bad as I thought it would be, but I should get used to disarm the drone to get it to land. And the last test I then did in the garden was with the GoPro on top, which during the first run worked surprisingly well. But during the second attempt, the system oscillated a bit and got out of control. I think this is a good time to mention that I'm using the standard PID values for my drone here, which do work but are not perfect. So next I wanted to do a bigger test on an empty field, which clearly showed me that I will have to practice quite a lot to get any decent results with my drone. And worst of all, as I was getting more comfortable with it, it just stopped its motors at the highest point yet and crashed to the ground. Why? Needless to say, I had to replace a couple of 3D printed parts, and I'm not sure why the system abruptly stopped working. Maybe because I was only using half of the original copper wire, or maybe because I forgot adding the ESC capacitor. Whatever it was, this problem did not occur again after fixing those things, and I was actually getting a bit more comfortable the second time on the fields. I got so confident that I finally tried out flying with the goggles on, which made things easier and on top was an incredible experience. And with that being said, you should now have a basic idea of how to make your own drone. And always keep in mind that you can easily downgrade component parameters to not only save money, but also make your drone lighter and less powerful. Because truth be told, my one is a bit too big and powerful for my taste. But anyway, if you enjoyed this video and maybe my other ones, then consider supporting me through Patreon. As always, don't forget to like, share, subscribe and hit the notification bell. Stay creative and I will see you next time!